Good morning, everyone. Today, we gather to honor the life of my mom, Maureen O'Hara Simpson, affectionately known as Liz. Born on April 28, 1951, Liz graced this world with her presence, leaving an indelible mark on the hearts of all who knew her. From her early days, Mom embodied passion and spirit, guided by the loving hands of her parents, Colin and Elaine Ford. Growing up alongside her sister Joan Simpson and later her brother Colin Ford Jr., Mom navigated life with determination and grace. Educated at the Catholic school, Mom embarked on her journey into adulthood with resilience and ambition. At just 16, she began her career as a switchboard operator at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, demonstrating her work ethic and dedication from a young age. At 19, Mom made the courageous decision to seek new opportunities in the United States, driven by her desire to create a better life for herself and her loved ones. There, she welcomed me into the world and devoted herself to her work in the front office of the Madison Towers Hotel. In the midst of the challenges brought by the COVID-19 pandemic, Mom decided to return to Barbados to help our family care for her aging mother. True to her word, she remained steadfast by our family's side, embodying the values of love and loyalty that defined her. When reflecting on my mother's life, there are certain qualities that stand out above all else. She was a woman of unwavering commitment, not only to her job, but to the people she worked alongside. Her colleagues were not just co-workers, but cherished friends. And Mom's selflessness knew no bounds as she supported them through thick and thin. Her sense of style was legendary as she dazzled with her beautiful smile, graceful demeanor, and timeless elegance. Whether preparing for a night of dancing or a social gathering, Mom exuded confidence and sophistication, leaving a lasting impression on all who she crossed her path, But perhaps my mother's greatest legacy lies in her generosity of spirit. Beyond her immediate family, Mom had a wide circle of friends who she considered her extended family. She was an incredible friend. She loved with her whole heart. She possessed a boundless capacity for kindness, always willing to lend a helping hand to those in need. Her home was a haven of warmth and hospitality, filled with laughter, music, and the joy of companionship. As we bid farewell to my mom and your dear Liz, let us find solace in the knowledge that her spirit lives on in the hearts of those who loved her. May her memory be a source of comfort and inspiration, guiding us to live our lives with the same love, generosity, grace, and compassion that she so effortlessly embodied. Rest in peace, Mom. Though you may be gone, your light will continue to shine brightly in the lives of all who had the privilege of knowing you. You will be dearly missed, but never forgotten. O God and Heavenly Father, grant to us the serenity of mind to accept that which cannot be changed, courage to change that which can be changed, and wisdom to know the one from the other, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Mom, may your memory always be a blessing.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of baptism, Maureen died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him eternal glory. We sing our first hymn.
Thank you. Please be seated for a moment. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this church, St. Patrick's Cathedral, as we come together to give God thanks for the life of our sister, Maureen Simpson. She's gone ahead in death. We pray that the Lord will receive her and grant her eternal life in his kingdom of heaven. On behalf of this parish here, this church, and the priest and community, we extend our deepest condolences to her family, which is her daughter who's here and other children who aren't here, but all the family, all of Maureen's family. We pray that the Lord will comfort you at this time and to let you know that you have our prayerful support. For all of you who have come to share your support, thank you for being here, and pray that Maureen will rest comfortably in the arms of the Lord. But every funeral is an occasion for us not just to think about our own death, but to think about how we are living, how we are preparing ourselves for our own end, which at some point will come. So let us, in this celebration of life, as we thank God for her, also thank God for the many ways in which he has blessed her, in which he has journeyed with her, in which he has kept her in being, and now that she has gone ahead, she's left this earth, that again, that she may rest in eternal peace. I will invite you and encourage you. I know some of you may not have been to the Catholic church before and a Catholic funeral. There are some prayers I'm going to say, and all I want you for you to say is amen. And amen means I believe what you have said. I'm not going to say anything that you can't believe. Believe me. So just say amen and say it with, because remember, this is not about us. This is about Maureen. So let's do it for her. So let's now stand as we continue. So brothers and sisters, of which we all are, we have come together to renew our trust in Christ, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death, and by rising has opened for us the gates of heaven. So let us pray for our sister Maureen, that she may share in Christ's victory. We pray also for ourselves, that the Lord may grant us the gift of his loving consolation. And God of loving kindness, listen favorably to our prayers. Strengthen our belief that your Son has risen from the dead, and our hope that your servant Maureen will rise again. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. We listen now to our readings.
Read it off and just read them.
No, this is okay. Yeah, we don't have a different.
Okay. Good morning to the congregation. A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. There is a season for everything, a time for every occupation under heaven, a time for giving birth, a time for dying, a time for planting, a time for uprooting what has been planted, a time for killing, a time for healing, a time for knocking down, a time for building, a time for tears, a time for laughter, a time for mourning, a time for dancing, a time for throwing stones away, a time for gathering them, a time for embracing, a time to refrain from embracing, a time for searching, a time for losing, a time for keeping, a time for discarding, a time for tearing, a time for suing, a time for keeping silent, a time for speaking, a time for loving, a time for hating, a time for war, and a time for peace, the word of the Lord.
We'll now sing the responsorial psalm, He Lives. We sing together.
The Lord's my shepherd, but I'll not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He lives, He lives, He lives. I know that Redeemer lives, He lives, He lives.
Good morning, everyone. The reading today is going to be from Revelations 21, 1 to 7. It says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of from heaven, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is among the people, and He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from our eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all of this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Amen. There goes the reading.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand now for our gospel reading. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come, you whom my Father has blessed, says the Lord. Take for your heritage the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. Hallelujah. And the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up the hill. And there he sat down, and he was joined by his disciples. Then he began to speak. This is what he taught them. How happy are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy the gentle, they shall have the earth for their heritage. Happy those who mourn, they shall be comforted. Happy those who hunger and thirst for what is right, they shall be satisfied. Happy the merciful, they shall have mercy shown them. Happy the pure in heart, they shall see God. Happy the peacemakers, they shall be called sons of God. Happy those who are persecuted in the cause of right. Theirs is a kingdom of heaven. Happy are you when people abuse you and persecute you and speak all kinds of calumny against you on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. So when Trisha came this past week to organize for this funeral, she showed me a photograph of her mom, which was taken from one of the death announcements in the newspaper. She showed me a few other photographs, and with joy in her voice, she told me that her mom was a beautiful person, not only on the outside, but also on the inside. She was one who was very giving, who was kind, and she was going to be 73 on Sunday. So happy birthday to her in advance. Each morning while sitting at the dining room table having breakfast, as a matter of fact, the radio remains on one station all the time, and it never changes. I'm not gonna say which station it is, but we hear the death announcements. And as you notice, the way they always seem to start, we announce the death of this person or that person. There's always a very somber tone to the announcements. Over in Grenada, they go a little bit further. And one of the funeral homes, Lacroix, they have a big screen. So anybody passing can see the death announcement, see who's died, when they're going to be buried, and so on. Like what we read in a newspaper, if we don't know the person, we get to hear something about them. Even when we know them, we might hear something that we didn't know before. I've often found that when I do funerals, I meet people that I haven't seen in a long time, like our brother there. We went to school together. Hadn't seen him in ages, so yeah. And Mr. Todd, I haven't seen him in a while as well. And every Sunday, the newspaper is filled with the names, filled with the faces of those who have died, those who have recently been deceased, waiting a funeral. This morning, a death announcement in the newspaper, which is also on the radio, says, we'll have a funeral here next Friday, and the tributes begin at 11:30. Now, that's confusing because we have Mass at 12, and nowhere we can have a funeral that begins at 2 and tributes at 11:30, unless you mean that you're going to have a whole bunch of tributes. But there was an error. The funeral begins at 2, the tributes actually begin at 1. So we have to get that corrected. So, you know, that's life. There's always, you know, errors. So we hear about those whose anniversary of death is being highlighted. Also, we see their faces, and in some instances, we don't see their faces. But we get to read things that are written about those who have died. And sometimes we didn't realize how many people or how much family a person might have had and where in the world that family may be residing. We may not know them, but we learn something about them from what is written down. And like seeing Maureen's photograph, we can see their face, so we have an idea of what they look like. We know their name, maybe if they were married or not, male or female, young or old, did they have a family, were they a son or daughter, a grandparent, uncle, aunt. We hear about where they worked and if they were involved in any organizations. And after all that, we then hear what church the funeral will be at, what cemetery they'll be buried in, should we send flowers or give a donation for some cause. Sometimes we're told not to wear mourning colors, which means dark colors. Not sure why dark means mourning, but anyway. Sometimes we hear that a person was a devoted wife or a husband or a loving child gone too soon. Sometimes you can't miss the death announcement because it's so big. And sometimes others are so small that it's easy to miss them. Next Sunday's paper will be filled once more with faces and names and more information about those who have died from our society. And sometimes even people who have died outside, they still get featured in our papers. But of all the things that people say in papers or even at eulogies or tributes, the thing is we can never really know somebody in totality. Sometimes the people we hold up as important in the eyes of society are very different when it comes to their private lives, especially when it comes to dealing with their own families. And one thing that I always like to tell people at funerals, you know, family really is the most important thing. And in life, with family, you know, treat each other with love and care and concern. Express love. Tell the people in your family you love them. Show them the love, because when they're dead and gone, you know, it's really too late. So when it comes to death, we want to think the best of those who have died. And yet some of our words can't change the content of a person's character. Father Paul, I'm sure you all know who Father Paul is. He always gives this, he's given this joke about this funeral, you know, and the pastor, the priest, you know, a priest like myself, was preaching, and he was very, very positive, and he was saying all these wonderful things about the man who had died. And the woman, the wife, and was sitting there with her son, she says to her son, look, you better look and see if that's your father in that coffin, you know. Because she knew the husband far better than the priest. So a lot of things that he was saying, she was thinking, but hang on a minute, that's not the person that I know. And so, but we obviously want to think, I don't think I've ever heard a eulogy of anyone where that person, you know, you say anything wrong or bad about that person. And yet none of us is perfect. But what is the content of our character? That's important. What's the content of our character? That's the kind of stuff, you know, Martin Luther King talked about. What's the content of, and he was talking about, you know, what's the content of my children's character? Because that's very important. So part of what we do and who we are must be affected by our desire to be as perfect as God, our Heavenly Father, is perfect, even though we know we cannot be as perfect. But we can try. We can do those things that show we are seeking perfection, that we are seeking holiness. And what criteria do we think God is going to use when we stand before Him, when He says, come, let's talk about your life. Let's talk about what you have done. Because He's not going to look at what we have. He's not going to look at what we don't have. He's not going to look at if we were rich or poor, black or white. He's not going to be concerned if we're Christian or Muslim or Hindu. At least that's what I think. He's not going to ask us if we went to church every Sunday, if we sang in the choir, and what we did in church. He's not going to be impressed by the fact that we can quote Scripture word for word and still not understand what it is that we were talking about, because we quote Scripture a lot of times out of context. He's not going to be concerned if we could speak in tongues. And in fact, if you could speak in tongues, Paul says you also need an interpreter to interpret those tongues. If we were a priest, a pastor, evangelist, prophet, whatever it is that we call the people who are, you know, our religious leaders. Because at the end of the day, I think that one of the things that God is going to judge us on is if we really showed care and concern for the people around us. Maureen was giving. She was a giving person. Like, and you know, like, and mothers especially, and I know this is not to belittle fathers, but mothers especially are people who give. And my mom has six children, and even now in my age, at my age, my mom still looks out for me. She still wanted to call me and say, come, I have some rock cakes for you, or I have some fried chicken or something, and I will go and pick them up. And she does that for her sons, not as much for her daughters, but for her sons, you know, mothers and sons, you know. So when we speak about what we are to do, or tell people what they are to do, a lot of times we aren't doing. You know, as Jesus said to the disciples, you know, yeah, listen to them, but don't do as they do. Because, you know, they like to do all these things, and they like to put burdens on you, but they wouldn't do the same. So what if death discriminated? What if death only came to older people or to the young people? Young people only. What if death happened only to the rich? Or if it happened to the many poor people that we have amongst us? What if it only happened to black people, or to white people, or Chinese, or whatever other races we may have? What if death happened only to the bad people? I think there's a certain sense that we'll all be happy if all the bad people in the world were gone. I saw a video yesterday that was quite disturbing, another robbery in here in Barbados, you know. What if those people were just like, disappear? But that's not how it happens. What about the good people, you know? What if death happened only to Christians and not to people of other faiths, other religions? So no matter how we think about it, death happens, and it happens to everyone. And death affects everyone in some way. And sometimes it happens to the person we least expect. And knowing someone will die doesn't make it any less painful. And worse yet, when that person, maybe you've had a good, solid relationship with that person, when that person dies, you know, part of you dies as well. And even worse, when that person is a young person, I think we feel the pain more so when that person is young and hasn't even really lived their lives. And the people who are most important in our lives, when death happens, at the times when we are most affected, and we mourn and we mourn. And there's no time period for mourning, but time is the greatest healer. As we heard in our first reading about a time for this and a time for that, it's not a chronological time. It's that the fact that in life, there are contrasts, right? I was going to say black and white, but black and white aren't contrasts. They aren't contrasts. When good and evil, good and evil aren't contrast. When goodness is present, evil is absent. When evil is present, goodness is absent. So when one is lacking. But there's peace, there's war. We have war going on in the world. At some point, there'll be peace. But it's not simply war in itself, war in itself. And the things of war that causes much destruction and pain to people. But death, unfortunately, does not discriminate. All of us in this church, we all gonna have to die at some point. We don't know when, we don't know how. Here in our church, if you look on the walls, these things, like, we call them stations of the cross, and they remind us of of Jesus' final journey, you know, into from Pilate's house to his crucifixion and death. And in one of the meditations, it says, I'm such a terrible person. I want to die this terrible, painful death. No, I don't want to die no terrible, painful death. Yes, I want to die. I don't want it to be terrible and painful because I'm a sinner. No, but we all have to. Death is all around us. And it's not just a physical death. There's death in relationships. There's death in when you have worked your fingers to the bone for so long, and then at the end of it, somebody says, well, thank you for your service. And you know that job, you have to split with that job that you have enjoyed for so long. That's kind of a death. Now what are you going to do? But death is all part of life. Things come into being and they go out of being. Anything created has a beginning, and everything that has a beginning has an end. And death is merely the end of one existence and the beginning of another. Paul talks about, those who are left alive will be taken up on the clouds, and we're still waiting for that. That's we don't know how it's going to happen at the end, and it doesn't matter how it happens at the end. It's not about and the end only will matter based on what we are doing right now. What we're doing now. So the body dies, the spirit lives on. That's what our Christian faith tells us, and that we are both body and spirit. When our body dies, it comes to an end. The spirit lives, and at some point, it's the spirit, however it happens, it's the spirit that finds its complete rest in God. So we do not know either who will be part of the kingdom of God, but as we live, we must live with our lives in ways that are in keeping with God's will. The Beatitudes that we heard in the gospel give us a good sense of these, this is what, in a sense, the kingdom of God ought to be like. This is what ought to be like. This is the kind of, almost the sort of the perfect society or the perfect world. But we live with our lives with our eyes fixed on God's kingdom, seeking to do what God has commanded us to do by first loving God and then the people that God has placed in our lives. If we say we love God and can't love the people in our lives, we're not loving God. So we are here because of death, because of Maureen's death. And we're here to pray for her. We're not praying for the dead body that's there. We're praying for her soul, for her spirit. We can do that. We can do that because we are praying to God. There's nothing we can do about her death. There's nothing that she can do. She has died and gone. But if we love someone and somebody's important to us, why not pray for them, for their soul, that their soul will find? But we say all the time, may she or he rest in peace or eternal peace. And that eternal peace can only come from God granting that eternal peace. So we're here to thank God for her life, for the 72 plus years, almost 73 years that she has, that God gave to her. And her life must resonate with all of us in some way, even for us who didn't actually ever meet her. The fragility of life must prompt us to always keep check on ours, for the simple fact that we do not know when our end will come, because our life can be short or it can be very long. But it doesn't matter how long or short our life is lived, as long as it's lived well, and as long as it's lived in honesty and integrity, as a merciful, just, caring, loving person. So when we die, we too will have our write-up, I think, in the paper. We will have our eulogies and all the lovely things that will be said about us. But when we stand before God, God isn't going to be listening. He hasn't listened to this eulogy. And I don't mean to be negative. He's not going to listen to these things, because God knows our heart, and that's the most important thing. He knows our heart. He knows who we are, and yet our prayer can say to God, our prayer can touch God's heart. So that's why we pray. But all the things that have been said, that will be said about us, what is the most important thing, or the most important person that we want to impress is God. He is the only one that can decide what happens to us when we die. Because all of this is not going to matter to God if we haven't lived our lives pleasing to God. So we will sing praises. We will say wonderful things. But God is more important than how we're living and how we are treating each other. It is very easy for us to think solely about ourselves because we're looking out for ourselves. Have we neglected to treat the people like another Jesus and to treat them as Jesus would do, as brother, as sister, because we are his brothers and sisters? So we wouldn't have another chance to do good because we live only once. And what we do or don't do will affect what happens when we die. We have no control of death. We have no control. And even for those who might commit suicide, they cannot pinpoint the exact moment that they will die. No one can. And so we have no control over death, as people may want to think. But as we're living, we have control over what we are doing as we live. As long as we live, and we have an occasion not just to simply exist, but to actually live and to try to make a difference to the world by, first of all, changing our lives, changing ourselves, and trying to help those, our children, to understand and understand the world, what it is that God is calling us all to. So of all the things that may be written about us when we die, and as we grace our papers and the people come to our funerals, whatever we do in this life must be done that pleases God so that we can be welcomed into his kingdom. We're not simply living to get the blessing, but when we live according to God's precepts, the blessing comes. We must always bear in mind, this will come to an end at some point. All of this will pass away. As we look at, as for those of you who've been around since, I don't know, the 60s and the 50s and the 40s, as you can see, even the landscape of our country has changed and continues to change. All around here is going to change in the next few years because life is not static. The world is not static. The universe is changing and unfolding. And each day we come to learn a little bit more about ourselves, as we should strive also to come to learn a little bit more about what God is calling us to. But let us pray that at the end, when our end does indeed come, and let us pray that as Maureen's journey has come to us, well, not a stop, it's not ended, the journey has now, it's now continues in a different way. That we pray that she will find rest in God's kingdom and that God will find each of us worthy to enter into his heavenly presence. So let us live with hope for a brighter future, not only as we live now, but also as we live, as we hope to live with that future in God's kingdom. Live with the knowledge that when this earth life has ended, there's a home awaiting us. Remember Jim Reeves? You know, well, we all know Jim Reeves, not the young ones. They don't know who Jim Reeves is, you know. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through, you know. You remember that song, right? It used to play on the radio every Sunday. Remember when Sundays used to be just for religious music and no other things, but now we get everything. But that's how, because life has changed. You didn't go to the supermarket on Sunday. You went to the side door of the shop. You couldn't buy alcohol. And they had to wrap it in a newspaper or something for you. But it doesn't mean it's necessarily bad. It just means that life changes and progresses. So live with the knowledge that when this is ended, there's a home. You know, like if you travel somewhere and you've traveled away from home, like you've gone away and you're so looking forward to coming home. You know, like Barbados, you know, this is home. And this is home for many people. And when we travel, we want to get back home. And no matter how things get in the country, this is still home. And this is where we want to be. So heaven, but heaven is the real place. Heaven is the home away from home. Because there is where we'll be united with all the other people who have loved God and who have served God and who all merit a place in God's kingdom in heaven. And so we pray that that's where Maureen will find her eternal rest, in the presence of God with the angels and all those who have gone before. Isaiah paints a wonderful picture of this great banquet of food you know, a banquet of people from all nations and languages, all sitting around the table, a great image of what heaven could be like. And so, let us pray for Maureen's soul. We pray for her family, pray that you'll be comforted, and may she rest in eternal peace in the kingdom of heaven. So eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May she rest in peace. Amen. I invite you to stand once again as we now have our intercessions. So, my brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voice of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his, and our response will be, hear our prayer. In baptism, Maureen received the light of Christ, scatter the darkness now, and lead her over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our sister was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome her into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy. Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy. And many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. And Lord, in your mercy, we pray in a very special way for Maureen's family, those here present and those who are not here. And we pray also for you, her friends, who have known her at different points in your life and her life. We pray for you as you seek comfort and consolation. We pray that the Lord will heal your pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Lord, in your mercy. And we are all assembled here in faith and with confidence to pray for our sister Maureen. Lord, strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We'll have collection at this time, and we'll sing our next hymn.
Sing sweetly in the tree. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul.
Son, not sparing, send him to die. I scarce can take him in. That on the cross I burden gladly bearing, he left and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul. Let us stand. And now we pray as Jesus Christ, the Lord, taught us to pray as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we come to the final commendation and farewell. But before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. And one day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. You respond by saying, Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to her aid. Hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. May Christ who called you take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. And to you, O Lord, we commend the soul of Maureen, your servant. In the sight of this world, she is now dead. In your sight, may she live forever. Forgive whatever sins she committed through human weakness, and in your goodness grant her everlasting peace. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. And now let us take our sister to her place of rest. And Maureen, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. And again, we extend our condolences to all her family, and we pray the Lord will comfort you. Remember, you have our prayerful support. And as we go, we'll sing our final hymn, To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done.